Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Rita Rai-Chaudhry. I'm the principal of Wells Community Academy High School. Wells is a traditional neighborhood public high school that offers comprehensive and rigorous academic programming, along with a wide range of arts and other extracurricular options, social-emotional learning opportunities, and much more. Wells is committed to developing the whole child with personalized attention to their needs and set them on their path towards success in college, career, and in life. Families who experience Wells call it a hidden gem. Unfortunately, despite being a neighborhood high school, only 40% of our student body actually come from the neighborhood. Why is this the case? We will explore bits of that today in today's session while we dig into why neighborhood schools are great options for students and great places for the community to find common ground. You're about to hear a few thoughts from Wells freshman Dorian Thompson. He is from the neighborhood and, despite many options, chose Wells. After Dorian, the executive director of Generation All, Beatriz Ponce de Leon, will transition us into the program for this evening. I hope you all have an eye-opening and informative evening. Thank you.
Everybody should have a fair chance at education. We all have the potential to do whatever we want to do. As high schoolers, we're basically like the next generation that's leading the world. Some people in the school could possibly be doctors who end up, I don't know, curing cancer. Everyone here has the potential to change the world in one way or another, and everyone deserves a chance to show you who they are.
Thank you so much for joining us, and thank you, Rita, for hosting. I am Beatriz Ponce de Leon. I'm the executive director of Generation All. I'm very excited about this program. It is the first in a series that we'll be doing this year to take a look at the education ecosystem in Chicago, and especially to shine a spotlight on our neighborhood high schools. So I really thank you for coming out tonight to be part of this discussion. We have a couple things to go through before we get started. And first, I just want to ask you if you all picked up a folder at the front. The folder contains some articles related to this work, also resources from the Chicago Community Trust, and the program is in there. So if you don't have a folder and you would like one, just raise your hand. It's something that we can get to you in a minute. Okay, and in this day of technology, we're very active on social media. So if any of you are on Twitter or on Facebook, I invite you to post while you're at the event. We would love for you to share this with the people that follow your accounts. This is really part of generating discussion across the city about our public schools and specifically our neighborhood public high schools. So there should be in the program the Twitter handle for Generation All, for Raise Your Hand, which is our lead co-host, and then also a hashtag. We're trying to use today the hashtag CPS Success and also Neighborhood High Schools Matter. So all of that is in your program, and I really encourage you to use that. There should be Wi-Fi here at Wells that's available to us. If you could find that, I think you should be able to log on. And then one more thing, just before we get started, I want to say thank you to people that helped to put this program together. So thank you to the Generation All team. There are several of us running around, but especially Ms. Suzu Schechsnyder, who is about to have a baby in a week, and she managed to pull this program together. Thank you to our co-hosts. We have a group of co-hosts. Raise your hand, and their volunteers are here working the registration. We have the Network for College Success from the University of Chicago, the Grow Community, and Solorio Academy High School. And all of them helped to get the word out about this event, so thank you so much for that. And then finally, just thanks to the parents and the students who will be sharing their perspectives with you in our fishbowl discussion with youth, and then in our panel discussion with parents and the principal. And of course, our two kind of celebrity guests, we have Linda Lutton from WBZ, who will be moderating the conversation, and Elaine Allensworth, the director of the consortium at the University of Chicago. We thought that this program was a fitting combination of the research, what the research has told us or is telling us about CPS outcomes and about students in Chicago Public Schools, and then also the perspectives of the families that are the users of our Chicago Public Schools. So we hope that what we share with you today will inspire you to look beyond school ratings and test scores, to take a second look at some other schools, and also to know what questions to ask as you make some decisions for yourselves and your families. So with that, I would like to introduce Elaine. I'll just give you a quick overview of her background. Elaine Allensworth is the Lewis Sebring Director of the University of Chicago Consortium on School Research, where she conducts studies on what matters for student success and for school improvement. Her research has been used across the country to create tracking systems such as Freshmen on Track here in Chicago and in other districts that are being used to make sure that students are on a path to graduate from high school and are prepared for success post high school. In addition to studying educational attainment, Elaine conducts research in the areas of school leadership and school organization, and she frequently works with policymakers and practitioners to bridge research and practice as part of panel discussions such as this one, on policy commissions, in working groups, and in a variety of other settings in both local, state, and national organizations. Elaine has received a number of awards and has published numerous journal articles and studies. Her work is frequently covered in the local and national media, including the New York Times, the Chicago Tribune, Public Radio, Ed Week, and CNN. And we are really excited to have Elaine join us today. Thank you, Elaine.
Great, thanks, Beatrice, and thank you, Generation All, for inviting me to be here. I'm really glad to be able to talk about some of the research that we've been doing at the UChicago Consortium, looking at Chicago high schools. You know, we hear a lot all the time in the media about all the problems going on in the schools. Obviously, budget problems, a lot of political conflicts. These are all, you know, real and serious issues that are facing our schools. But I think a lot of times lost in that is how Chicago schools are actually performing. And when we look over time, we've seen huge improvements in Chicago public high schools, so much that other places across the country look to Chicago and are asking what is happening there, because Chicago schools look so good. If we look at ninth grade freshman on track rate, this is a leading indicator for high school graduation. So we've seen huge increases in the number of students who are starting ninth grade and being successful in ninth grade. It's an incredibly predictive indicator of what's going to happen, whether they're going to end up graduating. So we're getting close to, you know, a projection of graduation rates that are close to 85%, which is way faster than what we've seen in terms of the nation, in terms of improvements in graduation rates. And, you know, currently nationally, schools are at about 81%. In terms of their graduation rates. So we're getting close to approaching the nation. And it's really important to remember that, you know, Chicago serves a lot of students who are, living in, in poverty or have a lot of struggles at home for financial reasons. That really affects comparisons of schools. So when you look at Chicago public schools, you want to compare students from similar backgrounds. And when we do that, Chicago looks really, really good compared to other schools across the country and across Illinois. So we've seen improvements in freshmen on track rates. High school graduation rates have gone up from 57% to 74%. That's four-year graduation rates that are even higher if you look 5 years. Still have a ways to go, but, you know, a lot of schools are now getting close to almost all students graduating. We have way more students who are getting it to the end of high school. They're graduating. People have been saying, well, but is that real? Are students just being pushed through? Well, if that were true, we would expect that college outcomes would be worse, right? But in fact, we're seeing way more students are graduating high school, and at the same time, a larger percentage of those students are enrolling in four-year colleges. And on top of that, among those students enrolling in four-year colleges, they're actually graduating from college at higher rates than ever before. Right, so we're seeing improvements all the way through to four-year college graduation. Now we can change it. A lot of those improvements have been driven by neighborhood high schools. So all types of schools in Chicago have seen dramatic improvements in just about any student achievement outcome that you could care about. Certainly high school graduation rates, also ACT scores, college outcomes. But neighborhood high schools have seen the biggest improvements. And in fact, it used to be that charter high schools in Chicago had higher graduation rates than neighborhood high schools, but that's not the case anymore. Neighborhood high schools have caught up to charter schools. And all schools continue to see improvements in graduation rates, improvements in ACT scores, improvements in college outcomes. And in fact, we now have thousands and thousands of more students making it to the end of the junior year to take the ACT than we used to have 10 years ago. You know, 5,000 more students are actually taking the ACT. You would think with so many students moving through and taking the ACT, we might see a drop in ACT scores, because if students are just moving through, you would think, well, maybe they're not doing as well. But we've seen the opposite. More students are making it to the end of the junior year, ACT scores are going up. Students are actually in school more, they're learning more, they're doing better, they're taking way more AP classes than they ever used to, and also more students are passing AP classes. We now have thousands and thousands of students taking AP classes every single year. And we also see some improvements in students' grade point averages. So more students are graduating, they're graduating with higher achievement. This is a success story that I don't think gets told enough. I should also mention that students make higher gains on tests in Chicago than on average in the country, in the 100 largest districts in the country, and also in the rest of Illinois, by far. So students are learning more in Chicago schools than they are in schools in other places. Okay, so, you know, yes, Chicago schools are doing a lot better, but there's still a lot of variation, right? There's a lot of differences in high schools across Chicago. And, you know, it can be very challenging to figure out, well, you know, what are the different options for schools in Chicago? Certainly, there are a lot of different neighborhood schools, and because we're an open enrollment system, you can apply to go to neighborhood schools that are, you know, not where you are not in the attendance area. And of course, there are programs within schools. I can't even list all the programs. Some of the big ones that people know about are the IB program, CTE. There are the selective enrollment high schools, there are charter high schools, and then there are lots of different specialty schools. You know, way too many to list. You know, you can look them up, and I'm going to give you information on where you can look up all these different kinds of schools. You know, there are 150 high schools, and then when you start thinking about all the programs within the high schools, that can easily get overwhelming. One thing that we know from research is that when people have more than, say, four or five, you know, people like to have choices, it's good to have choice, but if you give people more than, say, four or five choices, a lot of times they just stop even thinking about it, right? So you don't want to be overwhelmed by thinking about every single school in the district, right? You want to try to focus focus your search. And there are different ways you can do that. And you can easily focus it down to a much more manageable number. The number one thing, I think, as most of you would probably know, is can you get there on time every day? And it seems really obvious. Oh, you can't hear me? Sorry. It seems like a really obvious thing. But the number one reason that students fail classes, by far, is that they don't show up or that they're tardy, right? So getting there every day on time has to be the number one thing. Coming to every class every day that you're not too sick to be there. And then, you know, all schools have some kind of admissions criteria. In the selective programs and selective schools, you may need to submit, or they choose based on your prior test scores and your achievement in the middle grades, their neighborhood boundaries, their lotteries for charter schools. They all have different admissions requirements. So I guess you don't know for sure where you're going to go. But you can have an idea of where it's likely that you will be able to gain admission. And that also can reduce your choice set quite a bit. I'm going to talk about some of those different kinds of schools. We see a lot of people, they'll just apply to Whitney Young and Lane Tech, and that's it. They've made their choices, right? But when you look at the applications, a lot of people apply just to those schools, even though they actually have really no chance of getting into those schools, right? So if there's information available from CPS for the selective schools. You can go to schools and find out about the enrollment criteria, and you can actually figure out, is this a school that you have a good chance of getting into? And you don't want to game it or anything. I mean, you want to apply to the schools that you really want to go to, but when you're thinking about your choice set, you want to make sure you're considering schools that you actually can get into, or have a good chance of getting into. And then there are a lot of charter schools and specialty schools that may, be really great for some students, but they may have a very specific kind of culture. Neighborhood schools are going to try to be more general and serve a wide variety of students. Neighborhood and charter schools, a lot of times, are serving a very particular kind of student. So you want to find out about the culture and the expectations at the school. And then there's issues of quality, and I'm going to spend most of my time talking about that. Because it's really hard to judge schools a lot of times. What should you look at? Should you look at academics, graduation and college outcomes, school climate? All of those things are really important. Okay, so what are some of the factors that matter for student success? So you want to go to a school that's going to add value to you, right? Where you are going to be particularly successful. And that's not going to be the same for every person. But we do see that students tend to be more successful than when they go to schools that are, first of all, safe and supportive. Certainly, students do much better in school when they feel like they're getting a lot of personalized support and attention from their teachers, where they feel like instruction is clear, where they feel like they're challenged, but they're not overly challenged without support. So you want to be challenged. You want to be supported. Students are more likely to go to college if they're in a school with a strong college-going culture. And schools are more likely to be successful if they have teachers that work well together with each other and that work well with families. And you can get information on all of this online, and I'm going to tell you where you can get that information. Okay? You also want to go to a school that's strong academically. But it can be really hard to figure out if a school is strong academically because it does a great job educating its students, or it looks strong because it gets a lot of academically talented students in the first place. If you're getting stronger students in the first place, you don't have to do as much in order to look good on performance metrics. And likewise, there are some schools that may not look as strong, but they're serving students that come in, say, with much lower test scores or weaker attendance in the middle grades. And they actually are able to get students to have stronger performance in high school. So we've been trying to figure out, to what degree can you use data that's out there on school performance to know whether you would benefit from going to a selective school or a school that looks good on performance metrics. So I'm going to very briefly summarize a couple of studies here, and we can talk more about it, and I'm going to tell you where you can get more information, too, about these. Okay, so one thing we looked at is, what do you get from going to a selective high school? Now, only students with very, very high achievement can get into a selective high school. So selective high schools, on performance metrics, they look amazing because they only accept very, very high achieving students. And what we find is that, students definitely report a strong academic climate in the schools, but we don't see that they actually add any value to most academic outcomes beyond what students get in high performing neighborhood and charter schools. So we do see some better outcomes at selective schools, if students go to selective schools. So they report better peer interactions and classroom behavior among their peers. They report feeling very safe in selective schools, strong instructional quality, good relationships with teachers, and that they're definitely challenged in their classes. But we don't see any difference at all in taking honors or AP classes, the time they spend on homework, their attendance, their sense of belonging at their school, their standardized test scores, their ACT scores in their junior year, their graduation rates, college enrollment, or college persistence. Made no difference that they went to a selective school on average. And then we see some worse outcomes. So that students who go to a selective school end up with lower GPAs than they likely would have had at another school. They're lower in their class rank. And for some students, they end up less likely to go to highly selective colleges, right? Because when you go to a selective school, it is much more challenging. All of the students are very, very high achieving. When the work is really challenging, it means it's harder to get good grades, and that actually can affect your later outcomes too. Okay, and it makes a difference where you are relative to your peers. I mean, there's a lot of advantages in terms of being around a lot of strong, high achieving students, but at the same time, for a lot of students, they're suddenly in an environment where they have never struggled in elementary school, and now, everyone else is getting it. It may not be as easy. And unless they're getting support, they can struggle when they get to high school. Okay, so that's what we see about selective schools. So what about schools that are not selective, but they actually look good on performance metrics? They have high graduation rates, they have high test scores compared to other neighborhood schools and charter schools. These are schools that don't select students on the basis of their prior achievement. Well, for these schools, we actually do see benefits from attending them. Okay, we see lots of better outcomes, peer interactions and behavior again, better safety, instructional quality, challenge, improved study habits, improved attendance, better ACT scores, higher rates of college enrollment, higher rates of college persistence. Okay, so it actually looking at those performance metrics for neighborhood and charter schools actually does tell you something. But there is one worse outcome, and that again is your GPA. When you go to a school with higher achieving peers, it's going to be harder to get good grades because it's going to be harder. Okay, and then there's the question of, well, what if you can't get into any of, you can't get into the selective schools, you can't get into one of those really strong neighborhood or charter schools. Does it make a difference in terms of, say, a mid-tier school versus, a school that's really struggling? And there we do see some benefits as well. So we see that students report feeling safer, graduation rates are higher, and students are more likely to enroll in college and go to more selective colleges. So that data does tell you something about your likelihood of showing better outcomes if you go to a school with higher achievement. But you always want to compare schools that are serving similar students when you look at the performance metrics. So I talked about different schools, but there are also programs, and there are programs for high achieving students. And in particular, I want to call out the International Baccalaureate programs. And these are programs that are located inside larger neighborhood high schools. There are also IB schools out there. We have not studied IB schools, but we have looked at what are the benefits from going to an IB program within a larger neighborhood high school. And there are clearly many benefits for college. Students who go to IB programs in their neighborhood high schools end up more likely to go to a four-year college, more likely to go to a selective college, and more likely to persist once they get to college. The key thing is, no matter where you go to high school, a lot of people think that your outcomes, graduating high school, going on to college, being successful in college, a lot of people think that those things happen at the end of high school. Those things actually are determined largely by what happens in the ninth grade year. So no matter where you go to high school, you really want to pay attention to, how students are doing when they're in ninth grade. And I think this is largely how high schools in Chicago have, one of the reasons they've shown so much improvement over time, is they've started to really pay attention to how students are doing in that transition to high school. That ninth grade year is really key because that's the year that students are learning how to do high school, and that's the year they're learning if they can do high school. And the patterns that they set for themselves in ninth grade are going to carry over for the rest of high school. And if students succeed in ninth grade, then they know I can do high school. If students fail in ninth grade, they will forever be wondering if they're going to succeed later on. Mindsets are incredibly powerful. Your belief of whether you can succeed or not, whether you belong or not, these are things that strongly influence how students do in school. And so you want to go to a school that's really paying attention to the ninth grade. And there is data out there, I'm going to show you where that is, where you can actually compare schools serving similar students. How are students doing in the ninth grade year? What is their difference in their ninth grade on track rates? You can go ahead and move. Just in ninth grade, to be on track for graduation means no more than one semester course failure in ninth grade. To be on track for college basically means getting B's or better in your classes, having a 3.0 GPA or higher. Another thing that people all the time think, oh, it's no big deal, coming to school. The number one reason students fail classes is because they're not coming. And the number one reason students end up not college ready is because they're not coming every day. So you also want to look, what is the attendance at level in these schools? We see that schools serving similar students oftentimes have very different rates of attendance. And attendance is what actually drives college readiness as well as driving high school graduation. A lot of students, when they move from eighth to ninth grade, they start missing a lot more classes. In fact, absences quadruple. I don't think students are sick four times as often in ninth grade as eighth grade. But you really want to pay attention to what's happening in that ninth grade year, because it can really, a lot of students see a decline in performance. Okay, so I've talked about a lot of things about high school. Things to consider when looking at school information. One thing is you want to look holistically. There are always going to be trade-offs. I've already talked about some of the trade-offs that exist in schools. You want to look at lots of different indicators of what's happening at a school. You also want to talk to people at the school, talk to people in your community, find out about schools. You want to judge school quality not based on who it served as much as how it's doing with the students that it serves. So you want to compare schools that are serving similar types of students. And remember, you know, 1 year may not be representative. And so you want to look, you know, is this a school that's been doing well over time or that looks like it's, you know, improving? And there's a lot of information that's out there in schools. PowerPoint will be available for you all if you want it. There's a lot of basic information about high schools that CPS puts out. They put out the cut scores for every selective enrollment school, and they have a calculator, so you can figure out what your score would be for the selective enrollment schools, and then you can see, you know, which schools you have a you have a high likelihood of getting in. That you can find the neighborhood schools, you can find out what your neighborhood school is where you have automatic admission. You can also, there's also a high school bound site where you can see photos and videos of schools. And then there's a lot of places you can look for information on school quality. So you can get school performance data and data on demographic composition of schools from CPS. You can get all that school climate information about students' sense of safety and their reports of support from teachers and the degree to which they're challenged from the five essential surveys, the My Voice, My School survey site. And you can also, through the Two and Through project site, you can see for every high school what their ninth grade on track rate is, what their college enrollment rate is, what colleges their students are going to after high school, what those their college graduation rates are. So you can actually see what's happening to students all the way from ninth grade to college graduation at every high school in the city. And the site allows you to compare schools serving similar students and look at, you know, changes over time. So you can get a lot of information like that. So I've thrown a lot of things at you. Hope it's not too much. But you can get more information on our website at the consortium at uchicago.edu. And this PowerPoint will be available for anyone. That's it. Thank you.
If you have a question, raise your hand. We're going to try to take three questions, and then Elaine will just keep the conversation going. And she'll be repeating your question so that we can get it on the CAN TV microphone as well. So if anyone has a question, just raise your hand. questions? Go ahead.
Okay, so my daughter is 10 and she plays these questionnaires like, are you a sporty girl? Or are you a kind girl? Are there any type of questionnaires that CPS has put together to help kids narrow their choices? That helps them identify who they are within the realm of their personal choices?
I see.
Yeah.
I haven't. Are there apps to help you figure out what the best choice is for you? No, there are no apps like that. I know the high school bound website that I put up, once you eventually, it's set up kind of like that. So you put in what are the programs that you're looking for, different kinds of criteria. They don't have all the possible criteria that you might want to put in, but they do have it set up to in that way so that you're putting those things in and then it pulls up a list. But I don't think, there's something that's going to be that specific yet. Yeah. That would be nice.
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about the metric of high achieving, non-selective, lit achieving, just kind of what those cutoffs are or plans to worry about.
Yeah, and we actually have those in I can't remember if it's in the flyer that's in the packet. I think there's a sheet that might have them, and if not, there you can find them in the original research that's on our website. But we used information that was available when students were in the seventh grade, that's publicly available, the average ACT score of the school at that time, and the average graduation rates. So these would, when students were in seventh grade. So if you're using the information that's available when you're in seventh grade, how might you think about a high achieving school versus a mid tier versus a low performing school. So it was really just based on ACT scores and graduation rates because we know that information is available. And when you do that, you can kind of see groups of schools. If you look at, the schools with the higher ACT scores and graduation rates, it does change over time, so I don't want to name particular schools because it's actually better to look at the data and the year that you're looking. You can definitely see the differences. And, we wanted to know, does it make a difference all the way along the continuum? Is it really just getting out of, really poor performing schools into, moderately better schools that makes a difference? Does it make a difference going to just the high performing schools? And we found, there is a continuum. So you get benefits all the way along. With most of the benefits we see at those high-performing neighborhood and charter schools that have, high graduation rates and ACT scores compared to other neighborhood and charter schools, other non-selective schools. And I think that, the reason they look better is because there's a reason that they have high performance. They're not selecting students based on prior achievement. Neighborhood schools, take all the students in the neighborhood. Charter schools select students on the basis of a lottery. In order to have high performance, you actually need to be doing something good, right? You need to be adding value, and so I do think that that's why they look better. While selective schools, some are probably adding value while others aren't. But, they're still strong schools. They're just,
Hi, I'm curious to hear your thoughts on the new Common App coming out for CPS students and what the impact might be on our neighborhood schools.
We'll just have to see what the impact is.
Can you repeat the question?
What?
Can you repeat what he asked?
He just asked about the new common application, which CPS has been working on for a while now. But we haven't studied it, so I don't want to comment on it.
Does any of your research cover how attendance to academic centers impact a student's success in high school?
We haven't studied that. I'm sorry. That's a good question. Don't know. Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry.
That's okay. All right. Thank you, Elaine. Thank you. And if you'd like to see more of the research, you could visit the University of Chicago Consortium on School Research. We also will have a PDF of the slides available on our website at generationallchicago.org. So we're transitioning now. We heard some of what the research says. We talked about choices and options. And now we will have a fishbowl discussion with some youth from a variety of schools. After that, a panel discussion with parents and Principal Raichaudhuri and Elaine to keep giving us more information about our neighborhood schools and just the variety of schools that we have in Chicago. So with that, I'll introduce Masuzu Sheck-Snyder from Generation All.
Hello, everybody. I'm going to call up some of our lovely students from our youth council and also some students that you might have seen before. Danelli Quiroz from Roosevelt High School, Karina Martinez from Curie, Stephanie from UNO Charter Soccer Academy, and Ray Burns, who is an alum of Foreman. So we're really happy to have you guys up here. Go ahead and come up. And we're going to do an activity from our youth council that we call Hot Seat. So one of the students, Ray, is going to go first. He's going to be on the hot seat. And the other students are going to ask him a question about his high school experience. And then I will be out in the audience for one of you guys to ask Ray a question after the students ask him a question. And then we'll repeat that for Stephanie, for Karina, and for Danelli. So we did this in our youth council as a way for the young people to get to know each other because they're all from different high schools. And we wanted to give them also an opportunity to talk about their high school experience, you know, honestly, and also in a safe space. So I'll give the mic to you. So we're going to share this one mic. So Stephanie, you'll ask the question first and then give it back to Ray. Okay?
All right. So my first question for Ray is, do you think that your whole high school experience, all those 4 years, actually prepared you for college?
Honestly, I would say yes. My 4 years in high school did prepare me for college just because when I'm in my classes, I find myself getting a lot of things better than students who came from like schools that had a lot more funding than even mine. So I do feel like I am prepared for college.
How did you end up at your high school?
I ended up going to Foreman because I was commuting to school for middle school and it was like a 2-hour commute. I didn't want to commute anymore, so I just ended up going to a school that was close to where I was living at the time.
So my question is, how do you wish CPS would work differently, and especially when working with neighborhood high schools?
How do I wish CPS would work differently? I guess if I could restructure the way CPS looks at neighborhood high schools, I would want them to view neighborhood high schools with as much importance as other schools that are getting more funding. Because neighborhood high school students and neighborhood high schools themselves aren't any less than other high schools.
So before we move on to the next student, anybody in the audience have a question for Ray? He graduated last June, right?
Yeah.
Where did he go now?
So what college or university are you attending now?
For my first semester in college, I was going to St. Edward's University, which is in Austin, Texas. But I decided to come home, and the timing was kind of off, so I'm taking a semester at community, and next year I'm not sure if I'm going to end up at UIC, Loyola, or DePaul, but it's going to be one of those three. Okay.
So my name is Stephanie Boyes. I go to Soccer Academy High School. It's an UNO Charter School in the South Side. So.
All right, and my question for you is, do you feel that your 4 years at high school adequately prepare you for what's to come next, whether it be college or work?
So it's important to mention that my school is pretty new. It's only 4 years old. So they're still kind of getting the hang of what to include, what clubs to include, what AP classes to include as well. But I think that it has prepared me well enough. I am taking honors classes. I think that the extracurricular activities that I'm involved in and the ones that the teachers are including me in have really set me up for what's to come and have really helped me aid myself towards college and especially scholarships because I'm a minority. So, yeah.
So my question for you is, I forgot my question. What's one thing you don't know about your people don't know about your school?
So I guess that like one of the things that people really don't know about my school is that because it's an UNO charter school, they believe that there's like a really big difference between CPS and UNO charter schools. There really isn't. It's public. We're suffering the same budget cuts. And I think, yeah, that's something that people don't know. Just like Chicago Public Schools, we're going through the same thing, and maybe even worse.
So my question is, what's an experience where you learned a lot or where really you grew as a person, whether it's like a school lesson in your classroom that you have learned that really changed your mind on something, or maybe an extracurricular that you did that, you know, made you see the world a different view? Can you maybe share that experience with us?
So I believe that one of the things that have changed me the most in how I view things is my honors classes. I think that the way that the teachers are setting you up, in a way that they're setting you like up in a different way and they're pushing you a little bit further more, is really helping me out because sometimes I struggle a lot and sometimes I fall under a lot of pressure. But they're always there to help me out, and they're always telling me, well, we're just preparing you for what's to come, for what's college going to be like, because college is nothing like high school. And we're just trying to push you further so when you're in college, you don't feel overwhelmed by everything.
Any questions from Stephanie or for Stephanie? At a charter school, is it big classroom size or small classroom?
Specifically in my school, I think compared to regular public schools, it's a small classroom size. In average, all of my classes, I have 8 subjects, including like Mandarin and 2 foreign languages. I have an average of like 25 students in each class. So it's a considered amount. It's not too big, but not too small.
So my name is Karina Martinez. I'm a senior in the IB program at Curie High School.
Hey, Karina. So, you know, Karina, we've been good friends for quite a long time now. And so you attend Curie High School. And, you know, knowing you throughout the year, you have really been an activist for a lot of neighborhood schools especially. So I was just wondering, how did you become not only an activist for, you know, fighting for CPS equity, but neighborhood schools? Because you've been really supportive of my high school.
Thank you. One of the ways I got into supporting neighborhood high schools was because I go into one, but it was specifically an experience I had in my junior year with my sociology teacher. He demonstrated all of the disparities that not only my school, but school like Donnelly's Roosevelt High School was experiencing. And we were able to see how we could, even though we went to different high schools, different parts of the city, we could all relate and we could all work together to fix a problem that we were all experiencing.
What factors did you take into consideration when choosing your high school?
I think I had a very similar mindset that a lot of eighth graders have, that you want to go to a selective enrollment school. And then when I didn't get into the selective enrollment school, I saw all the different programs that all the high schools near me had. And one of the programs that caught my eye was the IB program. And also because all of my family had graduated from Curie, and so that definitely pulled me to Curie more.
What's one positive takeaway that you got from your school that you feel you wouldn't have gotten had you went somewhere else?
One positive experience or thing that I have from my high school is definitely the relationships I build with my teachers. My teachers aren't just there from 7 to 3, they're there for hours after school. I have an experience when I was struggling in my math class, because I'm not very good at math, but my teacher stayed with me until 6:45 in the night, helping me study for the test the next day. And that test I got an A on, and it was an experience that I won't forget, because I could see all that my teachers do for me, and I know that people like my counselors, they'll sit with me and they'll help me make all the decisions I have to make about college and about what to do with my life.
Any questions for Karina?
Okay, I forgot about that.
Hi, Karina.
Hi.
What is one tip that you would give to a new freshman who's going to experience IB for the first time?
Don't procrastinate. I'm serious. Like, going from a middle school where I wasn't actually challenged to going to a high school where it was, like being in a program where they do push you, always don't be afraid to seek help. I know that's super hard when it's a new school, it's new teachers, but don't be afraid to take that step because it's definitely going to help you. I struggled with math all of my freshman year, and then I had C's freshman year, and I got B's sophomore year, and then my junior and senior year, I've gotten straight A's in math.
Thank you, Karina. So my name is Danelle Quiroz, and I am a senior at Theodore Roosevelt High School, which is in the Albany Park area.
So what is one experience or one teacher that has influenced you in your 4 years of high school?
So the teacher that has really shaped for who I am and throughout my years in high school, one of my teachers was Mr. McIntosh, and he was my civics law and law in American society. So I had him for 2 periods, like 7 and 8, so I was literally with him for most of my days. And he was really into civics, and one of the things that he taught in our classes was being really civically engaged with our school and with our community. If we see things that we don't like in our school, do something about it. Don't just complain. And also because he was one of the teachers that really wanted a student council, which was something that was never, we haven't had in such a long time. And so he founded a group of motivated student leaders, and he's there in our meetings, which I'm also proud to say that I'm president of student council. And also just a quick shout out, a lot of the SAC members are here as well, so maybe my SAC members want to raise their hands. So, you know, he really have built a community of student leaders that we also see each other as family. So I think one of the things that he has said is that, you know, no matter what your background from and no matter, you know, what school that you come from, like you're the one that's going to, you know, you are successful and that you do matter, and that, you know, a lot of the things that whatever people say is that don't let that get into you, you know, show them something else.
All right, so Elaine was making a really big point in the differences between a public high school and a selective enrollment high school. If you have the opportunity to go back to freshman year and have the opportunity to start new at a selective enrollment high school, like many students aim to go to, would you take it? Why or why not?
If I had the chance to go back to the past and decide whether I want to stay at a neighborhood school or selective enrollment, I would stay at a neighborhood school, because I think something is that you need to give it a chance. And And I think that if I was in a selective enrollment, I wouldn't have been making so many accomplishments that I'm doing today. I wouldn't be in the top 10 of my graduating class, ranked number six this year. I wouldn't be able to got accepted to a lot of the top universities, such as University of Michigan.
Thank you.
And I wouldn't have met some of the amazing, inspiring young leaders. I think my neighborhood school has really shaped me and really shaped what I want to do for my community, for my people.
So I know from watching your video that you have with Generation All that you take a lot of pride in the diversity of your school, but not just like when it comes to race and ethnicity, but also the diversity of students in the clubs and the ways they're involved in your school. And I was wondering if you could just talk about some of those specific ways.
Yeah, so if you have seen the video, I had a really sore throat. But some of the, like talking about diversity, like my school is just welcome. So last year, so we welcome a lot of new Syrian refugees that came to the United States. So, well, Roosevelt, that deserves an applause, come on. And they found a new home at, you know, not only in Chicago, but in Albany Park. And so there's a lot of refugees, a lot of new immigrants, but they have the services, they have the support from a lot of, you know, specialized teachers that does focus in that area. But also there's different communities in the school, whether you're in gaming or you're into anime, or not everything's about academics. And one of the cool parts is that my school, like, we don't have cliques. Like, everybody gets along. So, like, you know, a good example is in Student Advisory Council. Everybody there is a student leader, but everybody's really into comic books, some are into comic books, and then you have another group that are really into music, you know, they have like a rap group, or another one's really into poetry. So those are some of the things that we do have in our school, and I think through the clubs and activities that we do in our school, there's just so many diversity to celebrate, and we take pride in that. And also, fun fact, Albany Park is the most diverse neighborhood in the entire country. So that's also pretty cool as well.
One last question for Kelly. Okay, so first I'm going to editorialize and say that I think you've asked really thoughtful questions. And I work for an organization that does a lot of professional development, and I think you're a born facilitator. And I hope you consider a career in training people to do things. I don't care why. My question is, as just sort of average citizens of the city of Chicago, what do you think we can do to help support stories of schools like yours and of kids like yours to help us build a narrative in the city about the promise of neighborhood high schools?
Yeah, so thank you. So one of the things that I think, like, you know, as the audience here, some things that we can do. So I always tell this, but you have to visit the school. You have to get to know, whether it's visiting the open house or coming to the LSC meetings, get engaged in the school in some way, because you're going to hear from teachers' perspectives, you're going to hear from students' perspectives, and I think that's the most critical part, because, you know, as young people, when we were hearing about some of the stigma in our high school, that gets passed along through the people, through community members. So I think also, not only, we have to be upstanders, we have to stand up for these neighborhood schools, because they're in our community, and we see the good in our community, and we know that these schools are doing their best to support the young people there. So I think, like, stopping the stigma and they, like, hey, that isn't true what you heard about that high school. But I also think, like, social media is a very powerful tool. And a lot of these schools, they have an amazing website. So, like, for example, like Curie Musicality, that's an awesome music a cappella group. So they have, yeah. And they have, like, music videos that are on YouTube. So sharing that is showing, like, wow, look at what Curie's music program has to offer. I think doing little things like that, people do pay attention to that. So I think, you know, stopping the stigma, being upstander, you know, use social media as a tool and visiting the school, learning, because the teachers there, they're gonna have more specific things about, like, well, you can help volunteer at this event, or we have the friends of whatever high school. So I think, like, also getting involved with the high school is really important as well.
Awesome, thank you guys so much. Can we do another big round of applause for all of our students? Thank you. I hope you all enjoy just getting to hear a little taste of what our students are thinking and experiencing in their high schools. Our youth council meets every Tuesday, and I know for me it's a really big blessing to be able to work with them every week. So I'm gonna call up Linda Lutton at this point and our panelists for our parent and researcher discussion. I'm sure you all have heard Linda's voice. You may not know her face as well, but she is a reporter at WBEZ. She covers schools, education, and issues affecting youth. She has examined Chicago's dropout crisis, race and segregation in schools, school performance, youth violence. She covered the 2012 Chicago Teachers Union strike and the closing of 50 public schools. Her work has been broadcast on many different public radio shows, and she's received many honors, including a 2014 Peabody Award and a 2004 Studs Terkel Award for excellence in reporting on Chicago's diverse neighborhoods. So please join me in welcoming Linda Lutton.
Okay, hello everybody. What a great student panel, huh? That is gonna be very tough to beat. I can say I have three kids. One of my kids did go to Curie, and I can say that all of the kids who were up here, I'll say this as a neighborhood parent, I felt like my daughter's classmates were very much like the kids you just heard from. Super impressive all the time. And all right, now on to Ms. R. Is that how your students are? Tell us about your students and maybe tell us a little bit about, oh, can I call you Ms. R?
Sure, or call me Rita.
Okay.
My students are not here.
You think. They may be. Can you tell us a little bit about, from a principal's perspective, you've tried to raise the profile of Wells High School. Talk to me about, do you get many parents from the neighborhood coming in? What has it been like trying to get students enrolled, students to enroll in your school?
Yeah, so I think one of the students earlier said it best, is the best way to change perception is to get people to come inside your building. And I think that's how we have been able to categorically change the perception of the school. Actually, right before the session started today, I was mingling with some folks and I met a parent who goes to Ogden. She's sitting right there. whose child goes to Ogden, and she comes up to me and says, well, you have such a beautiful school, it's so clean. And I historically get that kind of reaction from people who step into my building for the first time, because they think that because this is a neighborhood school, there must be graffiti everywhere and trash on the floor and peeling paint. And clearly, if you had a chance to walk around, you know that's not the case. That's just the physical structure of things. But we host these things called Investigation Days and Shadow Days, where we invite elementary school students and their parents and faculty members to come in, sit in on classes, and talk to teachers, go sit in the lunchroom, experience what lunch is like. And I think that's what changes perception, when they are in the classroom and realize that the level of instruction is quite rigorous, when they realize that the students who go to the school are very helpful and are willing to show them around and sit with them at lunch and talk to them at lunch, and that there are not fights breaking out in the middle of class period, that when you walk down the hallways during class, you know, a lot of students aren't cutting class and hanging out in the bathrooms. So those are the perceptions that people in general have. I think that's the school of thought that's been perpetuated, especially in Chicago and big cities like Chicago, that neighborhood schools must equal poor quality of education. And I think that's the perception that we need to change. And all stakeholders need to come together in order to do that. And we've been very fortunate here at Wells to be able to work with lots of community organizations, and we have some great partnerships in order to kind of change that perception. And my face manager is sitting right there. I think our incoming freshman class next year is going to be one of the largest ones we've had in a while because of that consistent work. So thank you.
Congratulations. Congratulations. Okay, I want to get to introduce the other panelists. I'm actually going to have them introduce themselves. We've got two parents. Because of this mic situation, I'm just going to pass the mic over. But I'd like you to tell us, Steve Posey, let's start with you. Why don't you introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your son, who's a senior at Kenwood Academy.
Thank you, Linda, and thank you for having me here today. Again, my name is Stephen Posey, and I do have a son that's a senior at Kenwood Academy. My wife and I, we've relocated quite a bit for my job, and in coming back to Chicago, we had an opportunity to either move into Hyde Park or we thought about going to the suburbs. So we did, you know, a lot of the things that Eileen, you know, talked about in regards to, you know, looking at all the demographics and the numbers and things like that. And we found that Kenwood was ranked as good as any of the schools we were looking at in the suburbs. They sent kids to colleges just as much, and my wife is actually an alumnus. We also thought about, you know, the fact that it was a couple of blocks away from our house. Having, you know, lived the prior 5 years in Mississippi, there was no diversity, you know, there was not a whole lot of freedom for kids to do their own things. I mean, as a matter of fact, we were the diversity. So, you know, and coming back home, because we are from Chicago, we just wanted them to have more of a well-rounded experience. But of course, you know, coming back, we were thinking, got to get them into Whitney Young, got to get them into Lane Tech, you know, this the whole rat race of it all. But we found that, you know, Kenwood was going to meet his needs. We believe that based on the information that we had, as well as just, you know, the logistics of it all, and, you know, his ability to have some freedom and have some diversity in his experience. And I'm happy to say that all those things have been realized, and he'll be attending Florida A&M this fall.
Can you want to talk a little bit about your daughter too?
Okay, right. Madison would kill me, but yes, I have a daughter as well, and she's a fifth grader, but and coming back, so we were thinking, where are we going to send her to school? You know, the neighborhood school, none of the kids are from the neighborhood. I mean, I just found out being here today that Kenwood is only 50% neighborhood schools, I mean, neighborhood students. So in regards to my daughter's school, you know, we dropped her off that first day. You know, my wife cried just because of how it looked and the kids that were there. However, you know, through her interactions with the teachers, with the principal, I mean, she's just up there every day establishing a rapport. And so therefore, you know, Madison is doing great. They love her there. The school has achieved the highest marks they can get, and so we're very happy with that. All righty.
Okay, great. That's Steve Posey. We're going to talk with Benin Pendeville. Am I saying your last name right? She's going to introduce herself. She has a child coming into ninth grade. She's made a choice to send him, or they've made a choice, her family's made a choice to send her to the neighborhood high school, Amundsen. And I want to ask you a little bit about that. So tell us a little bit about yourself, a little bit about that decision, and especially when you made that decision and why.
Hi, everybody. As she had mentioned, I've got an eighth grader and a sixth grader at Coonley School. This decision, the process was kind of 10 years along. A lifetime ago, I was a Chicago public school teacher. I taught first grade at a neighborhood school that was a real gem, and I knew that they existed, but then I got married and succumbed to the story that we had to move to the suburbs. So we did, for 10 years. two different suburbs, in fact, and we did not find that sense of community, and I kept saying, once my kids are in school, it'll be different, and then they were in school and they weren't different. And you had mentioned that you were the diversity, we were the diversity. So there, a couple of incidents happened where I was just like, you know what, we aren't happy here, so we moved back to the city with young children, which is like the opposite of what, you know, you always hear. But what we did was we, the way that happened was we, when we would go into the city, we would try to find, we would go explore different neighborhoods until we found one that felt good, that felt like home. And then once we did that, I looked up all of the neighborhood public schools and we visited them, and Coonley was the one that just felt right. So we moved into the district because of the neighborhood school. My eighth grader is in the options program, but when we, which is a selective enrollment program, but it was the only school that we listed because we figured if she didn't get in, she would just go to the neighborhood program and it would be just fine. Our family has always believed in the neighborhood schools and how that is the core of the community. The funny story is before we moved out to the suburbs, we actually looked at a house across the street from Coonley, and we chose not to get it because the school wasn't what I wanted it to be. That house is now worth six times what it was when we looked at it. Don't get me started. But so then the high school process came along around fifth grade. We started thinking about it. I was like, we're not going back to the suburbs, obviously, and we believe in our neighborhood school or the communities. So I started, so I enrolled my girls in swimming lessons at Winnemac Park, which hosts in Amundsen, so I could spy. So they would be in their swimming lessons and I would walk around the school and I would look in the classrooms and I would watch the kids interacting with the teachers after school, and the kids were happy and laughing and they had great relationships and it felt good. And about a year later, the Friends of Amundsen had started and I started attending their events and I joined their board. And we just made the decision that we weren't gonna do any of it. We chose not to worry about grades. We chose to let our kids stay home when they were sick. We chose to take a couple days off to go out of town. We chose to not invest lots and lots of money in test prep. It wasn't always easy for my daughter. She was around sixth grade. She was really excited about it because she didn't want to have to think about it. But then her friends and other adults in her life would start putting those whispers in her ear. Well, you know, you're going to, I mean, they said some kind of horrible things. You're gonna throw your life away, your mom is ruining your life, you know, things like that. Yeah, and she initially, like, you know, we talked about leadership and sort of leading from the front and having, you know, people join you eventually with momentum, and that worked until it didn't, and then she was fighting me for about 6 months, and then she was telling me, you know, about how the kids in her class were all so stressed about grades, and a couple of kids, actually, their hair was falling out. I mean, like, extreme situations. And I put it in terms that she understood. I'm like, it's like the Hunger Games. And that was the switch that made sense in her brain. And she's like, oh, yeah, I'm in. She's like, I'm done with that. So we walked right in. I mean, we did apply for the programs, the IB program and the CTE, and she chose to pursue the IB, which is why I asked you that question, because she procrastinates all the time. Again, same thing, if she chooses that IB isn't for her, we're perfectly happy with the neighborhood program. So that's it. Oh, and now I'm president of Friends of Amundsen, so like she said, get in your Friends of group, get in your parent group, so yeah.
Great. Wow. So, wow, some pretty impactful stories, right? Elaine, I want to ask you if you could tell Chicago parents, I mean, you're a parent, I'm sure you come into contact with parents, if you could tell them one thing, like, what do you think one of the most common misperceptions is? Like, what do parents really need to know in terms of making these high school choices that they just don't seem to get?
That's a tough one. Yeah, thanks a lot, Linda. You know, I mean, first of all, I do think a lot of people don't realize the quality of CPS schools and CPS neighborhood schools. I think they hear a lot about the, you know, political conflicts in the press, and they don't realize that the schools are actually doing well despite all of the problems that you read about in the papers. I don't think they realize that graduates from CPS high school go to four-year colleges at rates that are comparable to national averages. You know, even though, you know, a lot of the CPS schools are predominantly low-income schools where students are going to have a hard time going to college, they're still at the same rates as you know, the national average. And that for a lot of, and when you compare students from similar backgrounds, you know, students actually have much better outcomes in Chicago. And I think it's a shock, honestly, to people because they don't realize how good a lot of the schools in Chicago have become. I think a lot of times they're not aware of all the information that's out there about the school quality. I think the fact that, and parents can actually get really involved in their schools, and they can learn a lot about their schools in a way that I think is, you know, a lot of people don't realize that, you know, there are a lot of opportunities here in Chicago. There are also a lot of opportunities in terms of, you know, after school and, you know, extracurricular programs, and that's really important. Another thing, sorry, I could just go on and on, but you know, when thinking about school quality, there's been so much of a focus on standardized test scores, you know, and I think as parents, we all realize that schools, you know, we want a lot more from our schools than just to prepare good test takers. You know, I think there are a lot of schools that are really working to prepare students for success in a more holistic kind of way. And that's another thing that I think you really want to pay attention to when you're looking at schools, when you're talking to people in the schools. What are they thinking in terms of developing students as learners, preparing them in terms of their opportunities for, you know, success in different areas, giving them challenges in more than just, you know, their academic classes, and really supporting them so they succeed in those challenges, because that's ultimately what's most important, that students, you know, learn, you know, that they can be successful, they embrace challenges, they know they can be successful, and they know how to be successful.
Okay, Ms. Reed, I want to ask you, I looked up some numbers before I came here. So, and they're very depressing numbers for a neighborhood high school. You know, this neighborhood obviously has changed a lot. Your attendance boundary is pretty big, but 93% of CPS students who live in your boundary don't come to school here. That's what school choice has meant for Wells High School. And we know some other numbers that WBEZ hopes to report at some point, that if all the kids in this boundary came here, you would have a tremendously diverse school. It would be about 30% white, about 30% Latino, and about 20% African American. How do you get there? And can you get there under the current policies that the district has?
I think the current policies that the district has segregates us in several ways. Income level, race, all the things that we want to get away from, right? So if choice wasn't the predominant driving force between how we select schools, high schools primarily, in the city, then we would have a school that was diverse like that, right? Because our school's doing well. It's not that our students come here and get a poor education. Our students go to four-year, highly selective universities with Fulbright scholarships. They have sports, extracurricular activities, three types of arts. So we provide them with a well-rounded, solid education with lots of support. The teachers and the staff members are passionate, dedicated. Our students are happy. Their hair is not falling out, luckily. Right, so we have all the things in place for our students to be successful, but the perception is out there that neighborhood schools are not good, or neighborhood schools serve a certain type of student population, and my child is not going to go to school with that type of student. So I think at a policy level, we can make some decisions where those things become non-issues, right? For example, if choice wasn't the driving force, instead, if we worked together to make sure that every single neighborhood school was supported to become the school of choice for that neighborhood, that they receive differentiated supports, equity, and funding. You know, instead of spending millions and millions of dollars in building new schools, which we're still doing, there are existing schools out there that have a lot of capacity. This school can hold 1,400 students. We have less than 400. So instead of building a new school somewhere, why not think about what we can do on a policy level to get the students who live in this neighborhood to come here, right? We have 13 charter schools within our neighborhood boundary. That probably wasn't a very sound decision. You know, it was a poor decision that was made at some level at some point in time. I don't know to what extent the community was involved in that decision making. I know we weren't, as a school that has existed here for close to 90 years. We were not part of that decision making process. So those are the kind of things that we would need to consider when we think about the messages we send in what we value in our education, the messages we send when we make it a choice-based system and not a system where a student can walk to his or her neighborhood school and it is just as stellar as the neighborhood school that another student lives in, right? I have students here who come from way south, far west, and they take 3 buses, a train. Sometimes it takes them up to 2 hours to get to school. That should not be the case.
Should we open it up to the audience? Should we open it up to the audience for questions? Are we good? Or do you want more of my questions? Or do you want your questions? While we're getting our first question askers, yeah, I was, maybe, Steve, could you answer that question of, that the student posed, of, you know, if you had it, do it again, what about the allure of Whitney Young? Would you choose Kenwood again if you had the choice?
That's easy, absolutely. I mean, what he was able to gain in just his own level of independence and what he has to learn as far as like navigating the bureaucracy of his high school and knowing who to talk to and developing these relationships and developing his own independence without needing me to get him anywhere or you know needing anything too much from his parents, it helped him grow, so absolutely.
Yep, we have a question from the audience.
Hi, I'm Philip Carey, and I'll chime in with a little bit besides Jen, which is a selective enrollment. But I have a question, it's not necessarily a question, but I'm also an LSE member. My child goes to a local neighborhood elementary school. But there seems to be a two-tier level of selective enrollments in Chicago, where people are, I hear the young being said a lot. And there are schools like Linville that are selective enrollment, where you don't have to have your ear fall out, and you can have, pay an 85 or 75 sometimes even score on your collaborative score to get in. I'm curious about the research about schools that are taking some kids that are not in the 99th percentile and doing some significant things with them and having a different funding level than say Ethan Jones or Whitney Young.
I think I missed the second part of that question.
So play schools like Lindblom also take kids that have a lower scores than 99 percentile, and yeah. When they're grouped into the select enrollment schools like Northside College Prep or Whitney Young that are taking kids in the 99th percentile, yeah. I'm curious about what you would say about their growth rates and the reality for another set of select enrollment schools.
Yeah, that's a good question. So I just want to say one thing, you're absolutely right. It's much easier to get into some of the selective enrollment schools than it is to get into other selective enrollment schools. And you know, many, many, many people apply to basically the same set of selective enrollment schools. And so that's why I would say encourage people to look at the cutoff scores when they're thinking about selective schools, to think about a wider variety. And actually, if you look at the climate in you know, all the selective schools and what students report about their experiences, they say, you know, very positive things about all of the selective schools, including the ones that are a lot easier to get into. One of the reasons that we see some of the negative outcomes for the selective schools, especially in terms of GPA and college selection, is that you know, it does make a difference if you are around like super, you know, very, you know, high achieving students and you are at the bottom of that group. You may be very, very high achieving student, but you are not always gonna feel like you are as smart as you really are. And you're gonna struggle and the classes are gonna be a lot harder. And we do think, you know, when we look at which are the students that are, that struggle the most at the selective schools, it is the students that are coming in, you know, with the lower scores and lower achievement relative to their peers. Which is, you know, not to say, you know, I think people have to figure out what's best for them, but you need to think about your support. I think we do have to ask our selective schools, you know, are you supporting your students as much as you really need to be? You can't assume just because a student is high achieving that they don't need support, because it really depends on the context. And we do see that the more that we ask of students, the more support they need to continue to thrive and to get good grades and to feel good about themselves and have those really positive mindsets.
Yeah. And can I just say, I'm a Lynn Bloom parent too, actually, my little one, so shout out Lynn Bloom. But I think, you know, one thing Elaine, one point she made today was to look, you know, more holistically at schools, much more holistically at, than just the test scores. And I would say as a reporter, I really find that to be true. I've found absolutely excellent teaching in places that I think people would write off as a low performing school. And I'll say as a parent who's had three kids in three different schools in this system, I think I've also seen that on an individual level with my three kids in three different high schools. It's not necessarily the school with the highest scores that is where the best teaching is happening. I think research would bear that out, right? I think research bears that out, right?
Hi, I just want to thank you all for your perspective. It was really valuable. And I wanted to elevate a common thread I've been noticing from the student panel and now this, in the value of community engagement, civic engagement, and youth leadership. And this is something that has been elevating, and I'm hearing a lot more than test scores and test prep. And to focus more on the value of what a neighborhood school can do and bring, especially for a community, and how much it can elevate these opportunities. I'm interested in learning more about how your schools are promoting and developing youth leadership and civic engagement, and then conversely, what are things that you'd like to see more of in your schools?
And can you repeat the question before getting your answer, please, for NTV?
Whoa. So she wants to know about civic engagement and your school's teaching civic engagement to the students, and where you want to see more done. You want to answer, Jean?
My kids are still in middle school, so I can't speak for the high schools. I mean, I know the high schools have different service clubs and things like that, but in the middle school, the different things like student council and different opportunities for them to find their talents. You know, my eighth grader is an artist, so she's always doing set design and, you know, different things like that. As a parent, that's something that I focus on. In my business, I have to do that, and so I've actually taken them with me to some of my professional development. In personal development, I've let them actually skip school to go with me for those, because I feel like it's a great education, and I didn't have to worry about the test scores or the, you know, grades. That's what I do. I try to model that with them and share books with them and different videos. There's a really great video, you guys should Google it. It's called the Lone Dancer, or The Dancer is a Leader, and it's this music festival and this hippie is out dancing all by himself and everybody's just staring at him. And then one person joins him and then they're the two weirdos dancing by themselves. And within like 5 minutes, everyone rushes down to join them. And that video, I've shown that to my kids multiple times to talk about how you just have to be that lone dancer by yourself until others join you.
Well, I guess we got it pretty easy with Kenwood because my son's required to complete 40 hours of customer service. I mean, community service. 40 hours of community service before he can graduate. But that's the minimum. So he's got about double that. So he's good to go. But we are lucky in that it's part of what they require.
Okay, great. We want to do that activity? Karina, do you want to answer? Yeah. Can you come to the mic so we can get you?
Okay. So talking about civic engagement, it definitely starts in the classroom. Had I not had most of the teachers that I experienced, I definitely wouldn't have the communications like I have with Generation All or like other opportunities. Like I work on the youth council with Generation All, and I've previously worked on youth councils with MCVA Challenge, which are both ways I got into with my experiences from my teachers. And it kind of, you start in the classroom, but you build up those skills to take it on your own. Like I recently, within the past like year and a half, I became a youth organizer with the Bryan Park Neighborhood Council. And that's something that I'm incredibly passionate about, and I know that it definitely leads to what you like. What I want to do in college, like I want to study political science. So, if you like relate what you're working on in the classroom, and then you take the leadership and put it into your own hands, you're able to do whatever. Yeah.
Okay, one more question. In the back here, do we have somebody to run the mic? Oh.
So I would have to say I agree so much with everything you've been saying about getting the word out that there are other options other than those handful of selective enrollment schools. But there are probably, so I'm hearing more and more about, I have a sixth grader who is, you know, at this moment convinced that she has to go to one of those schools, and I keep trying to say there are other schools and, you know, there are lots and lots of smart kids that are not going to get into those schools because the competition is so, it's just fierce at this point. And I know that I am hearing about, you know, schools in my area that are good, Austin and is one, and there are others that I know do a really great job. And so getting the word out is probably, you know, it's happening a little bit more. But there are still schools that are really struggling and are not maybe, you know, in the same position as Wells and Amundsen. And so I would like to know what you think is the difference in those schools and the schools that are really still not maybe a safe place or a productive place or an achieving place. What makes the difference? How has your school been able to say, we're a great neighborhood school, and how come some of the other schools are unable to do that? And I think I just ask this from the perspective of how, as a community member, can we help to promote schools that are not doing well?
So I'm going to repeat that question to summarize. Basically, summarizing some schools, we're hearing about some schools do better, but we still hear about how some schools struggle. Why is that? What role does the community play? And I'll add a part to that. In terms of what we hear about, is that just sort of buzz from middle class people? Is that what we mean when we say the schools aren't performing well yet? Is that what we really mean?
Thank you. So let me answer I'm going to take a stab at answering your last part first, and then I'll get to the rest of your question. So I think when we think about performance, right, it's a very stringent and narrow set of criteria that we are using when we're thinking of performance. So if we're using the school quality rating policy, the SQRP,
it has already predetermined metrics on there, such as standardized test scores, attendance, graduation rate, college enrollment persistence, and all of that, all of which are very important metrics. What they don't measure are things such as supportive environment for students when it comes to their social emotional growth, when it comes to helping students build peer relationships, when it comes to helping students build perseverance and grit, all of those things that will help them be successful in college, right? Because Elaine, your research found that there is really not much of a difference between persistence rate of students who graduate from selective enrollment high schools and go to a four-year selective university versus a student who may graduate from a mid-tier in quotes high school and goes to the same university. Am I right? That's what the research roughly found, more or less. So what sets a school apart that is being successful but may not show up as a level one plus school in the performance metric are things that they do in order to reach all students. So I can speak a little bit about what we do at Wells. We're not just, you know, using a one-size-fit-all plan for all of our students, which sometimes may be the case in some schools that are assuming that they're getting students with high social capital because they're taking in students with high test scores. They're still teenagers. Okay, just because they know how to do well on tests and get really good grades doesn't mean that they know how to navigate peer relationships. Doesn't mean that they know how to automatically transition from elementary school to high school, which is a completely different ballgame. So at Wells, we pay attention to all of those things. We actually don't start our academic curriculum for about 2 weeks after school starts. We take the first 2 weeks in what we call suspended curriculum, where we are teaching students how to transition into high school, teaching them skills around conflict mediation and building strong peer networks and building relationships with their teachers, self-advocacy skills, persistence, grit, work ethic, all of those things that we can't assume that just because you're in high school that you know how to do. And I would say that is a big reason why a lot of our students are successful, are on track. If you look at our on track data, actually the former principal of Wells is sitting there in the back. Wells's on track used to be at 49%. This was about a decade ago. We are now at 92%. Our demographics hasn't changed, right? Our demographics hasn't changed, as you pointed out. Right, because the neighborhood families aren't sending us their students. Our demographics hasn't changed, but we have been able to make the changes and the difference within the structures and the confines of our building because we pay attention to systems and structures, we pay attention to what our students need, and we pay attention to things that are more than just academics. Because if you are struggling if you're struggling with relationships, if you're struggling with your study habits, if you're struggling with managing your time or your organizational skills, you are not going to be able to do well academically. So those other things also need to be taught and reinforced in order for them to be successful in high school and build the skills that they would need to be successful in college, in career, and in life. Did that answer your question?
We have one more question I want to take from the person right here. Yeah. Thanks, Runner.
I just want to commend you guys for what you're doing. I actually had been working with family for 6 years trying to get everybody to stay in Chicago. I started something, and it all starts with parents, because I started something called the Hidden Gems High School Fair, which is actually a fair to highlight that there are more schools in Chicago than just your four selective enrollment and a couple of private schools. And so I do see when you tell families, you know, is it a matter of do you want your child to be a big fish in a small pond or a small fish in a big pond, that really resonates with them and they understand that. So Amundsen, I know we're actually, Amundsen is our host for our upcoming Hidden Gems High School Fair in September, and
We just love to highlight how neighborhood schools really are beyond that perception that you guys have. And so everything that the student panels have been saying and you guys have been saying has been resonating, and it's great to hear them. And I think families do need to just kind of keep on hearing it and have that promotion, because that really does. You're doing all the right things, you have Fulbright stuff, you have all the stuff, but nobody knows it. So thank you for doing this.
Are we doing the activity, or we're going to wrap up? Oh, Wendy? I introduce Wendy Catton from Raise Your Hand.
What is this? Do I go over here? I feel weird. Okay, this is odd. I want to just thank our wonderful panel. Thank you so much. Round of applause. Where are the students? I'm going to ask the students to come back up here for a picture when I'm done talking. This was really thought-provoking. My only regret is that we didn't do this much, much earlier. When I read Linda Lutton's story or heard it, The Big Sort, and I recommend that everybody look that up on high school, the sorting that's going on in our city. That's when I said, we have to have a panel like this. And it was actually, am I allowed to say this? Linda's post, a Facebook post that she made about her own experience with her children and their choices that they made that actually sparked this event. Can you guys hear me? I don't know, this just feels like it's not working. Which led to just such a really great discussion on our Facebook page, and Generation All reached out to us and we said, let's do an event. So. This is really important. As a parent of a middle schooler, I know that it's personally a tough issue, and it's something that we hear from parents all the time, that they want guaranteed access to an excellent high school. So thank you all. What else? What can you do from here? Well, share Elaine's research, I would say. I've shared it. I shared the selective enrollment piece, and there was a lot of information in there that just really surprised parents, especially the GPA thing that, a lot of parents, there are things just set entrenched in the mindset of Chicago around which schools are best that aren't always about which schools are best for your child. So follow Generation All, go look in the program, follow Raise Your Hand. While our high schools are doing great work and are improving, there are still policies that can work to support or undermine our neighborhood high schools. And I think it's important, whether we find a good school for our kid or not, to be mindful of those policies. And so there is a lot we can do. If you enjoyed the program tonight, think of donating to our organizations. There's a donate button on both of our websites. What else? Thank you to Ms. Suzu. I can't say it. Sheck Snyder. Sorry. For creating the program for tonight and doing so much work, and the awesome volunteers. The parent and students who helped us out. Thank you guys so much. Where are the students? Please come up here for a photo. Are they still here? The panelists? Did you all leave? Come on up. And also, there's still food out there, so feel free to grab some food, mingle out there for a few minutes, I'm sure. Thank you to Principal Rita for hosting us tonight. Thank you so much.